Our next term proves that guitar heroes can have O-levels.
Yes, kids, but studying doesn't mean that you can't rock.
It does cut into your time with drink, drugs and loose women, though.
All of which are wrong, obviously.
I always know when Brian has put a bit on somebody else's record. You know, even if he hasn't told me, I know. I know it's this guitar.
Brian May was very fortunate in that he had a very nice and kind dad who'd got an old mahogany toilet seat.
It came from the part of an old fireplace.
We made it out of shoeboxes and shoes.
So it's all made from strange objects, pieces of junk, really. A knitting needle.
You made the knobs.
Oh, yes, a piece of shelf edging.
And he'd fashioned a guitar, which they called something like the Red Meanie. Not only that, Brian played the guitar with a sixpence. And this was the band to watch in 74.
He had sort of long, curly hair, which I thought was very good. That's a plus. He was obviously very articulate and intelligent.
Armed with rock's most famous DIY guitar and a degree in astrophysics, Brian forsook the telescope for the axe and some equally brainy bandmates. Taylor, Imperial College, Drums and Biology. Deacon, Bass and Bachelor of Science, First Class. And when the first singer didn't work out, they looked to a Zanzibar-born design student for inspiration.
Freddie's already been to our gigs and gone, yeah, you're great, you know, but you should do this and you do that. And we thought he was like, you know, all talk, I suppose. And Fred goes, well, I can sing for you. You can sing. Turned out he could.
Queen were born, a great big glam prog panto. To begin with, not many people understood them or their music.
Everyone said, oh, you know, disc jockeys are not going to play this because it takes too long to happen. So 70s arrived, we decided we would put the kitchen sink in, all of it, in the first 8 bars. And if you listen to it, you'll know exactly what I mean. The whole Armageddon.
The kitchen sink approach produced their first hit and a lashing from the critics.
And I thought, I don't think we're going to get on with these people. I remember having that feeling, you know, and it, sure enough, you know, we come along and they hate us from the beginning.
Is this the real life?
Their response? Write a 7-minute rock opera, release it as a single, then get a leg up from a friend.
I guess you have to mention Kenny Everett.
We gave him a copy, officially to listen to, but he was winking as we gave it to him. Just killed a man. He played the song and partial parts of the song, I think like 14 times over the course of the weekend. Of course, by the time it got to Monday, the kids were going to the record stores and wanting to buy the single.
Kenny's teasing and some newfangled thing called a promotional video took Queen to number one for 9 weeks. And while Freddie had Galileo fandangoing with Beelzebub, Brian came up with one of the rockingest moments in, well, rock.
I made sure that there was a suitable bed for the solo, because I could kind of hear the solo in my head as a tune. And obviously the heavy part, you know, the bit that you headbang to in your van, you know.
Bohemian Rhapsody marked the start of a decade of unremitting success. There were plenty of costume changes, but the riffs remained the same, as Queen became market leaders in aristocratic rock excess. Brian got an ulcer, got better, became a tax exile, came home again, and by the time Bob Geldof rang up about something called Live Aid, was one of Britain's highest paid executives.
Inside us, we're wondering who we are, you know. We're wondering if Queen is this huge thing that we've built up, this huge organisation, and can we actually pull it off? It gave us the confidence to realise that actually, even without the extravaganza, we were still us and we could still move people. So it was a great thing for us.
Post Live Aid, everyone loved Queen again. But the final date of their 1986 world tour in Nebworth was to be their last, though the really bad news didn't come for another 4 years.
The music world has been paying tribute to Freddie Mercury, the lead singer with the rock group Queen. He died last night, just 24 hours after saying he had AIDS.
Good evening, Wembley and the world!
Getting up on stage with him, that was pretty memorable.
And Brian's axe duet with his hero-worshipping hair-alike wasn't his only flirtation with the doppelganger effect. Before and after Freddie's death, Brian added his unique sound to his now wife's solo project and launched his own solo career on the back of a car ad. But there was still another number one in the offing.
We were looking for an anthemic rock song, you know, that we could kind of five up.
They said, can we sample your guitar and put it on the record? And I said, well, if you're going to sample my guitar, why don't I play?
And the hair remains the same.
I think I'm blind to fashion, to be honest. I've never been fashionable and I never will. I'm just me.